Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, residents of town of Sunderland. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. Today's date is June 20th. Figure out that one for a second. I'd like to call the order at about 6:39. Scott will not be joining us this evening. He got called away, so we will not have Scott tonight with us. But before I like to start our meeting, I would like to acknowledge the passing of a gentleman from the town next door to us. And while Phil Gilmore Sr. may not have had, many in Sunderland may not have known him, many that have served as EMTs or learned about EMT and took classes probably had Phil as an instructor. I was talking to Bobby earlier today, and the first time Bobby Ahern went through his class, Phil was his instructor. So I would like to offer a moment of silence in the memory of Philip and offer our thoughts and condolences to his family, which includes Mark, who is a selectman, Blake, or was a selectman in Deerfield, Blake, and Phil, and Sean. Thank you. All right, the first thing we have tonight is we have a appointment with the library director, but Catherine isn't here yet. We also have a meeting with Dory Hurd to talk about OPED, because it's riveting discussion.
Yes.
Right, Sherry?
Yes.
It's a page turner.
Yeah, and we'll keep you on your edges of your seat. So because of that, we're going to try to get through the other parts of the agenda before that. So next up is the minutes of the June 6th meeting.
Make a motion on the minutes.
Yeah, well, second, all those in favor of acceptance of the June 6th meeting as presented, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We got a 2-0 on that, Sherry. The next up is Board of Selectmen updates. David?
I just got a quick update. We had last Friday, we had a meeting about our long cable contract, which has been dragging on for 10 years. Looks like we went through some of the final last revisions, and it looks like they're going to finally get something over to us so that we can actually sign something.
Congratulations.
So, yeah.
The only thing I can say is that the Comcast contract is probably the largest contract that any of us ever signed. When you look at the total volume or total cost, it's staggering.
That's a 10-year one too.
And it's 10 years, so I don't know how these work out, but it seems like every time we do have a negotiation, we always go and we get extended. But it's a whole bunch of dollars. And to tell you the truth, you don't know. This may be our last one we ever sign. Who knows what's going to happen in 10 years?
Be. Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if this is it.
Then who knows where the technology will be in 10 years?
Plus, it's not exclusive like they used to be. So.
Yeah. Anything else, Davey?
That's it this week.
Okay. Board of Updates from myself is that the South County EMS Board of Oversight met last Thursday. We accepted the recommendation of the building committee that and we had two responses to the RFP. One was from the town of Whately renting a location in their facility over on Sandy Lane, which is now the Whately Town Office Building. The other one came from two buildings. One is the old South Deerfield Fire District, I believe, building, and there's a building right next to it. And that was offered for sale at $650,000, I believe. The building committee, screening committee, scored it. They the Whiteley building scored highest with the all the people that were doing the thing. But when it was looked at, there was something different in the configuration because of the, I believe from what was said, was that may have occurred because of the Frontier Union 38 that may thinking to go into it. So the advice from Deerfield Town Administrator was to reject all bids and then make a motion for the to recommend the Whiteley facility and recommend that the Deerfield Board of Selectmen enter into negotiations with Whiteley for a spot for South County EMS. So that's where we stand right now. And I think that's it from my side. Town Administrator?
We have a meeting tomorrow with a representative from Energia and Guardian to finish up the building envelope and insulation projects under the green communities for the safety complex and for this building. The order of taking and the planning for the School Street land was recorded on June 11th, and we're getting ready to send the notice of taking to the owners known. And last week I attended the public forum that the Community Preservation Committee held regarding a possible park grant application for improvements out here to the town fields and riverfront. And I think the general consensus after that meeting was that we still had some more homework to do. There were concerns raised regarding parking and maintenance of town property in the fields and a possible impact to the river. So we've decided to, the consensus was to hold off for another year and to consider looking at conceptual designs and working with the community to develop the project.
Good. Anything else?
And that's it.
We wrote a letter, right, to...
We wrote a letter. We sure did. To the DPU.
Yeah.
To the Department of Public Utilities concerning the way... Our utilities are public. They're public utilities, meaning that they're granted basically monopoly protection. But every once in a while, the state wants to know how they're doing. Unfortunately, we didn't have a very good experience with our solar project, which I don't think is an unusual occurrence from what I hear. So last 2 weeks ago, the Board of Selectmen had voted to have a letter written to express what happened with ours, and that letter was submitted today.
It was delivered today.
It was delivered today. So, and again, there are different, and it's part of doing business. And they know it, we know it, and we try to put all the cards on the table. So that went away. Now, Sherry, you're also working on looking at grants for streetlights?
Streetlights, yeah. We have a lot of projects going, just doing the feasibility and trying to run numbers and figure out how to make it work. So I've reached out to Eversource. Ken Garber sent an inventory and a cost to buy the poles. I also reached out to Fred Davis Group, who does LED lights and has the state contract, to get an estimate for the pricing for the lights. And I've reached out to Gilbert Mooring in Amherst. Amherst does some maintenance of LED streetlights. And I reached out to the town of Gilroy, Purrington, to see what their experience has been and to get some information.
Now, have you talked to Chicopee also?
Not yet. No.
Because they also have a municipal light. Chicopee has their municipal light and also South Hadley.
Right, South Hadley's got their own, yeah. You forget about that sometimes. Yep.
Oh, I mean, you don't see what Amherst says. UMass does too. UMass has a utilities department.
We're looking at it for potential green communities. I think DOER is going to be rolling something out. Right. We've got something from them today, and then it's also eligible under Complete Street, so we're just trying to find fit and feasibility right now.
Yeah, that'll be good.
Okay. All right, thank you, Sherry. FY17 reappointments.
All righty.
David?
Let her rip here. I'll go through the list. It isn't too bad because it's just the highlighted ones here. All right, the following will be up for reappointment. Drake Thompson, Gail, Jess Wissman, and David Wissman. Those are all for the 300th Anniversary Planning Committee for 1 year. And we have Stuart Beckley, Scott Bergeron, Carl Fiocchi, Tom Feidenkevitz as an alternate, Patricia Patnod, Leon Markowski, Jeff O'Brien, and Lauren Starr, all for 1 year appointments for the 120 North Main Street Committee. We have Megan Arkin for a 3 year Ag Commission appointment. And then we have this one name that pops up a bunch of times here. Sherry Patch for 1 year appointments to the Network and Electronic Resource Agents Procurement Officer, ADA Coordinator, PVTA Representative, and Ethics Municipal Liaison. And we have Bob Ahern for the SCEMS Boo for a 1 year, and Steve Benjamin for the Sunderland Emergency Preparedness Team for 1 year. And then for the selectment committees for North Main, we have Scott Bergeron. We've got Tom Feidenkevitz for the 120 North Main alternate and the SCEMS Boo. And then we have David Pierce for the Teacher Union 38 and Instructional Assistance negotiations. So, motion for that.
And seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Sherry 2-0 on the recommendation of on the motion by Mr. Pierce. Congratulations to all the reappointments. And our town wouldn't be what we are without your volunteer and your service. So it is a huge thing for us that we have people that are so interested in serving. So thank you very much. Correspondence, David?
Yes, I have right here exciting news. We have been awarded a community compact grant for IT. And this is from our governor. Dear Scott Bergeron, it is with great pleasure that I inform you that your community has been awarded a $24,534 grant through the Community Compact Cabinet's Information Technology Grant Program. The competition for the $2 million of available funding was intense, with more than 100 eligible municipalities applying for grants totaling more than $16 million. Your application was chosen because it clearly met the overarching goal of driving innovation and transformation at the local level via investments in technology. Lieutenant Governor Polito, as chair of the Community Compact Cabinet, and I want to congratulate you for becoming a compact community and striving to make your community a better place by virtue of implementing best practices. Your participation not only provided you with technical assistance, but it also placed you in a more competitive position for other state grants such as this IT program. I am glad to see your community taking advantage of the benefits the CCC program offers. Attached are grant documents that need to be completed, and that's really it. That's just a piece about completing the documentation.
So Sherry, you want to talk a little bit about this grant?
Sure. We applied for and received the grant for a voice over internet protocol. So it'll be a new state-of-the-art telephone system that will help us improve efficiencies internally here at the town office building. And it'll also help reduce costs because we'll no longer have the outdated Centrex system. So there'll be cost savings involved as well. And we'll also be doing some Ethernet improvements, firewall, and those kind of things here.
Yeah, it's good. It helped us do a lot of stuff that we've been trying to get
right
to for a while. And that'll free up some money for other things or just savings.
Right.
So.
Excellent.
That's good.
And I guess this, and again, I can't overemphasize how hard Sherry has worked, not only on this IT grant of Community Compact, but through the streets as well, the Community Compact through streets and best practices with those safe, what they got, safe streets, I think they call it?
Complete streets.
Complete streets. Yeah. And Sherry's really on the forefront of keeping us right on the state's radar about this stuff, getting us there early, getting the information to us, and having programs ready to go. So thank you very much, Sherry. Yeah. Excellent job on that.
Thanks. A lot of opportunities going on out
there
right now,
it
seems
like,
which is good.
Well, you know, it was interesting. I was reading today, they were talking about states and the tax burden of the states, and everybody continues to refer to Massachusetts as Taxachusetts. This, the thing that was, well, today, what I read was sort of look at the total tax burden. And that means state income tax, personal property tax, excise tax, all the form, even, you know, how you, your taxations on sales taxes and stuff. And
we still in the middle, or where
18th?
Yeah.
18th. So I just think, you know, so Massachusetts has changed, and again, we think it's expensive, but when you look at it compared to a lot of other states, it's we're kind of towards the middle,
yeah.
But we're not doing too bad for ourselves right now. Good. All right. Note signing sewer relining project. We had it downstairs.
Yes.
For signature.
I think that's in that large
pile.
It is. Pile.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, we had a CPA grant for the historic restoration of the Rio fire truck as well. We're all set with that, Sherry?
Yes. Yep. That's in your to-be-signed pile, too. It's been reviewed by council and approved for your signatures.
Okay. All right. Anything else?
I will check in with Catherine tomorrow. I may have been confused on the dates. So.
Okay.
I'll reschedule.
We know where she lives.
Okay.
She knows where we live also, so.
Okay.
Also, as an update, selectman update, Scott is still in negotiations with the individual that we had originally chosen as a chief of police. We haven't heard one way or the other how the negotiation's going, but I guess earlier I asked Sherry and she said Scott and the potential chief have another meeting scheduled for this week, right?
Yep, Wednesday at 4.
Wednesday, so. Mm-hmm. So we see where that goes. Okay, next up. We are going to be riveted as we talk about OPEB.
Yeah.
You can come right up front.
Rivet you now.
Come on up.
Okay.
It's kind of like infrastructure. It's, you know, they're always talking about how important but not sexy it is. So, so I always hear that constantly, you know.
It's one of those wonderful subjects and topics.
Exactly.
My name is Dori Ewart. I'm with Bartholomew & Company. And before I get started, we sent some booklets out. Do you have these? If not,
we
I will.
Do have them.
They're
downstairs.
Yeah.
That's fine. I have extras. So I will. It's okay.
Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you for having me out here tonight. And before I get started, I just want to get a feeling for what you're hoping to get out of the meeting. Is it just to understand who we are, or do you want me to give a 101 on what OPEB is and where we're at? Wanted to see.
I think an overview would be nice.
Right, especially for
viewers.
Don't,
don't forget, you're on TV.
Okay.
So we use opportunities like this to help our residents understand what they're looking at. So an overview is a great start. So
wonderful.
Well, and again, so you know, you understand the need of police station or police force and ambulance and firefighters and school teachers and principals, but sometimes people don't know about the other stuff. So that's what we like to have a better understanding.
Okay. Well, as a preface, let me introduce my company. Bartholomew Companies is a locally owned independent investment advisory firm located in Worcester, Massachusetts. We have over 23 employees with the firm, and we currently work with over 200 communities in the state of Massachusetts, of which over 100 of those actually have started an OPEB account with our firm. I am a former treasurer, tax collector for both the town of Paxton, and then I was the former treasurer for the city of Fitchburg, currently on the board of assessors for my own hometown, which is the town of Paxton. I have worked 11 years with Bartholomew and Company, and one of the unique things about our company is that we bring together our investment expertise with over 22 years of investment. Actually, there's over 30 years of investment from Tom Bartholomew, but over 22 years of investments as the firm, a separate independent firm. And we mix that with two individuals, myself and Chuck Patterson, which I believe you've met, mm-hmm. right? Who is also a former treasurer. So our job is to get to know the laws, know the rules and regulations, know the accounting requirements of the cities and towns, and kind of blend those two together for you. OPEB stands for Other Post-Employment Benefits, and these... where you have pension benefits for your employees, this would encompass anything that you also give to your retirees. So that would be your health insurance, if you offer life insurance, and any other type of benefits that you offer to your retirees. In most communities, I see it mostly being health and life, but there are other benefits that some communities do offer. And what's happened back in 2005, the Gadsby regulations. Now, Gadsby is the Government Accounting Standards Board, and they set the accounting standards that all government agencies, so whether you're a small or a large town or a city in Massachusetts, the state, the federal government, they have to have a way of the rating agencies to look at your financials and comparable to other communities. So the Gadsby sets the regulations of how you have to report your financials. And when they looked at these, what they consider or what are unfunded liabilities of the community. So you have promised your employees that when they retire, you're going to pay 50% of their health insurance costs for the rest of their life and for the rest of their spouse's life. But yet most communities had not put a dime aside for that. They paid out of their regular budgets. And what's been happening, and similar with the pensions, they become a larger and larger piece of the budget to a point where they said, you need to start accounting for this. So how much is this liability going to cost you in future years? And more recently, the rating agencies are looking to say, what are you doing about that? So it's become a very hot topic. So again, the accounting standards came into effect in 2005. You were required as of 2009 to start those, putting those on your financials. And more recently, you not only have to put them as a footnote, you now have to put it into your balance sheet. So you have a fairly large unfunded liability sitting out there that now pulls into your balance sheet and goes against your financials. And I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, that you have adopted Section 20 of 32B, which allows you to establish a trust.
Yep.
And you put some funding towards that?
Mm-hmm.
You've started that. Okay. So the way the state of Massachusetts set it up is that they put this Section 20 of 32B saying that you can establish a trust, you can put money in the trust, and we want you to invest it the way a prudent person would invest that type of money given the time, that type of time frame. So technically, money that you're putting into this trust is something that, according to your actuary study, they're showing you how much you should be putting aside a year. And that's over a 30-year time frame with you having that invested in the stock market and earning a reasonable amount of return, anywhere between 5 and 7% of return. If you simply put it in the bank, especially with interest rates the way today's interest rates are, you're earning less than 1% on the funds. So the state allowed you this mechanism to put the funds away invest it like similar that you do your pension funds. So you can get that out there. You can have the funds themselves earn money so that the entire cost is not borne just on the taxpayers. The funds themselves can earn money and add to the fund and help out for future generations. Rating agencies, like I mentioned before, are looking for you to start addressing these unfunded liabilities. What they look for when you go out to build a building or do some borrowing, a 20-year purpose, they want to know 20 years from now, you may not be on the board, somebody else might be, and these unfunded liabilities might be a much larger piece,
right.
And so you're not able to, because you have to fund this, you have to fund your pension, you have to fund your debt costs. You may not be able to fund your police department. You might not be able to fund things. And you might get into a situation similar to what happened to Detroit, where they had to declare bankruptcy. And people who are lending you money want to know that in advance. And that's why the agencies use these numbers to say, here's their financial practices. And they're starting to make steps so that we think that they're a good risk. Or they're not looking at it. They haven't even done their actuary study. We think they're fairly poor risk. So they rate you on those numbers, what you're doing. This whole thing came out, like I said, you had to start reporting in 2009. We were, at the start of a very deep recession. And they realized communities and government entities could not come up with money to start putting aside at that time. But as things are starting to clear, they expect you to put together a plan as to how you're going to fund it. And they don't expect you to fund it overnight. It's a large liability. They expect you to have plans in place that over time you will get to the point where you're fully funding what they call the ARC, the annual required contribution. That would be the amount you have to pay for today's employees and the amount you have to put aside for future liabilities. So that's sort of OPEB 101. One of the drawbacks about the state's law when they passed that is they did not actually build a trust into it. They said it was a trust, you adopt it, you can trust and you can invest the money. But your auditors and the actuaries that do your accounting, your accounting reports, these actuary studies, they said, you know what, we don't feel that this is an irrevocable trust when you simply put that in, say I have a trust, and it's not irrevocable, because they said state legislature could say, similar to what they did to stabilization 20 years ago, they can amend the law and say that you have to give it for employees, to pay for retired employees' health insurance or any other purpose. By simply adding those few words at the end, you can use it to buy a fire truck with. So they want it buckled down into an irrevocable trust. And they have proposed legislation, the governor's modernization bill, for 2016. The actual trust is being written right into that modernization bill right now, which it's been passed through. It's still active. I believe they have till sometime in July, maybe the end of July, to pass that bill, and that may automatically give you the availability to have an irrevocable trust right there built into the law, that the state's going to take care of all the communities, realizing that they, the first version of their legislation was not perfect.
Did that go through both houses, or
it got through committee, and now it's because they had to pull that modernization bill had
a lot
in it, and they had to put it in a lot of different committees. So it's gotten through committee. It's still active on the bill. It did not get pulled out. So there's a lot of favorability on the bill as a whole, but it has not passed yet. So it's still pending there, and to be honest with you, I didn't look to see where it was today, but it's still out there. I had an update on it last week, and everything was moving forward. So, but it's government, so we have to wait and see how that goes. But that's just where that is as far as the trust goes. Meanwhile, the state says, and over 100 communities that we have, and I'm sure there's a whole lot more than that, they said, the legislation that they gave you allow you to put the money in and allow you to invest it, and you can move forward with that. It's just your rating agencies or your auditor might say, well, I don't think it's a really good trust, so that type of thing. So we've had some communities that have adopted their own trusts waiting for this to happen in past years, but I think we're fairly close to it happening on the state level for you. All right. So why, why not just go pay as you go? Okay. So I talked about one reason. The rating agencies aren't going to like that for much longer. They want you to recognize your liability. But number two is if you do get the money, some money starting putting into a fund, and you start investing it, and you have an investment history, they're able to change your discount rate. So right now, and you know, when they first started doing the actuary studies, we would go across the state, and there were discount rates between 3% and 8.5%. The discount rate is the future value of the present money. So when you know, somebody retires 20 years from now, what's the cost of their health insurance? And that was a fairly significant cost at the time. So that discount rate, whatever yours was, they've changed some more Gadsby regulations and buckle that down. If you're not putting money aside, you cannot use a high discount rate. You have to use a low discount rate. And if you are putting money aside, how are you investing it? If you're putting it in a money market account, you still have to use a low discount rate. But if you've got your money and you've got it invested and you've got a good track record of continuing to put money in and increasing that amount and getting closer to the arc, you can raise your discount rate. Every 1% change in that discount rate. So if your discount rate was 3 and you bumped it up to 4, it reduces your outstanding liability by 10 to 20%. So significant reduction in your outstanding liability and the amounts you have to put aside by just simply getting money in, having it invested, letting the investments help you build
that. So we can take the money and go down to Foxwoods or Mohegan Sun?
Yeah.
Well, if that's what a prudent person would do with the given restrictions.
Well, it's funny. We had a treasure collector interviewee one time, and the reason the person wanted the position is that they like to dabble in the stock market.
Oh, yeah. So I'm... well, dabbling is not exactly a great...
we didn't hire that person.
That's good. Cities and towns are typically fairly conservative. the laws that allow what you can invest your general fund money for, your operating money, is very restrictive. And then you have stabilization, trust funds, and longer-term funds. It's more restrictive, but they give you a little leeway. There are 23 stocks that you can actually put some investment in, but most of the time in most communities typically have 75 to 90% in government bonds, CDs, safe, secure securities that, you know, they're going to get that money back. Extremely conservative. We're a very conservative firm because we work with so many communities. We're used to that. I came from an era when I only had to invest in government bonds and was getting 7.5-8% off of those. Those days are gone.
Yeah, I was going to say. Those days are long gone.
Date myself, but still, but you need to be a little bit beyond that. If you need to get a 5% or 6% or 7% return, you need to get a little more aggressive than that. Certainly, we use securities that we try to get you there by taking the least amount of risk. So we use a lot of risk-adjusted return securities in our company.
So you're still following pretty much the rules that are established by the state. I mean, in your investments. I mean.
Well, the investments, what the state established for OPEB investments was what they call 203C, which is a prudent person rule. And basically what it says is, given this amount of money, what would a prudent person invest this in, given the length of time? Think. So a prudent person, I liken it very much to your pension funds, or if you want to think of it in individual terms, a 20-year-old going into, you know, his first job, or 21-year-old getting out of college, going into their first job, and they got to start putting money away for their retirement. Okay, it's going to be a long time before they're going to collect that money. So they put it in, and you just kind of every year just keep putting more and more in, and eventually, you know, when you go to retire, hopefully there's enough money there for you to retire. Now, if a 20, 21-year-old worked with an advisor, and this is what they wanted to, you know, they got a plan, he'd say, this is how much money you have to put aside. And that's where you want to get. As you get closer to being fully funded, you think of it closer to a 60, 65-year-old person who's going to start drawing on that money and wants to keep it invested so they have a nice income coming in, but maybe they don't need to take on as much risk as they go there. So we typically, we set up a series of typical funds, say, for communities that go from conservative all the way to aggressive. And our even our most aggressive is probably more moderate than fully aggressive when we build that. So we typically recommend that you need to get to aggressive at some point in time if you want to get that 7.5 mm-hmm. return. But depending upon the risk levels of the community, we have some that say, no, we need to stay conservative. We just can't take a risk right now. We've had other communities that have moved into moderate, have been with us for many years, have built up a nice cushion. So this is the amount the taxpayers have put aside. Here's our growth. We can get a little bit more risky because even if, you know, some of this growth goes away, we haven't touched the money that the taxpayers have gotten, and we need to make it grow.
They allocate the increase to the more aggressive?
Well, no, they just take the entire portfolio. So they make it a little bit more aggressive because even in down markets, you have a nice cushion so that when the markets come down, you're not eating into the money that the taxpayers have actually put into it.
So like on your chart here, like for the aggressive, you've got 55% in equities.
Yeah.
I don't know what page number that's on, but I'm just looking at the spread on that.
Yeah. That would, if you look at aggressive, in today's market, aggressive, I would think of it in a 70% equity and 30% bonds. In today's market, we need to use alternatives to get us there, okay?
Right.
So we're spreading some of the alternatives, some of that, some of the bonds and some of the equity into an alternative funds that help us get there.
What do you use for vehicles for the equities?
Well, when the amounts are small, we use mutual funds.
Okay. So are you looking at like index funds or?
No, we use active funds, actively managed funds. We'll divide them up between, you know, large cap, mid cap, small cap. We don't go right through the full allocation. We have, I have an investment team. I don't do the allocations myself. I have a full investment team back in the office, and they do all the analysis work. They look for fund managers that are best in class, that have proven histories. Mm-hmm. They follow the managers. They're not opposed to moving others in and out, depending upon how their performance are doing. Our goal is net of our fees that we outperform markets. You set the risk level, and then we try to outperform those. The other thing that we recommend, and I put a copy in here under tab 4, is an investment policy statement. So we build the investment policy statement based on current law, and then when you go into page, if you start on page 7, this is where you set your risk levels. And I believe this one in the middle is our moderate portfolio. So your target is 45% in equity. It can go down as low. You give your investment manager, they can bring that down as low as 35%, up as high as 55%, depending on how markets are. We rebalance at the time, and but the standard is to get to, the target balance in the middle. And this is where you set. So you tell us, I want conservative, moderate, aggressive, even super aggressive, which we don't have many communities on there. We don't typically recommend super aggressive. I think we have one community that wants to go there. So, but we help you pick out your risk level. You set the, and we kind of think of these as bumpers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not going to let your equity get below 35. And that's important to know, as sometimes on committees or individuals get scared, as in 2008, mm-hmm. and they sell out as soon as the markets get to the bottom.
Right.
And then they don't want to buy in until they're all on charging on full engine. So, you know, we need the leeway to adjust within if mm-hmm. we feel things are happening. But but you gotta set the bumpers on there so that an individual isn't running scared at the wrong time.
Do you typically adjust it, like the new contributions as they come in, rather than shuffling the portfolios around more so?
We, anytime new contributions come in, we use that as an opportunity to rebalance. We also rebalance during certain times if we've had an aggressive run up of the market or even an aggressive downturn, we'll rebalance during those times also.
Okay.
So we do the investment parameters. We actually spell out definitions of what the different asset categories are, and then we agree upon indexes that we're going to use to measure our performance again.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask about next.
And,
like what
so you know, there are any number of indexes that, but we'll help set the indexes that we'll want to use to measure our performance. We come out on a regular basis. A minimum we require that we're out here at least once a year. We can come out quarterly. We've had people want us out more often during certain markets and less often other times. But the treasurer is the custodian of the funds. So we provide monthly, quarterly reports to the treasurer. We usually stop in on a regular basis to check in just to make sure things are going on board. And then we meet. If you have a trust committee, we would meet with the trust committee. We'll meet the select board. Whomever is interested in, you know, in this particular fund.
So you do quarterly statements essentially on it?
We give a monthly statement.
Okay.
They'll get a monthly statement. We do a quarterly reconciliation report that meets all the GASB requirements so that for the town records, it's just convenient for the town. So we'll do all the accounting reports for them. And then quarterly online, we offer a full report that shows performance numbers, market history, gives a lot of that data. So they can pull that report off quarterly. And then we actually hand deliver a full fiscal year report, you know, so that we can, because in the markets, you're generally dealing with calendar year. So we know you deal with fiscal year. So we deliver a full fiscal year report in July for your fiscal year and change the numbers of that for you also. And then always in the January to March timeframe, we also bring out a semi-annual fiscal year. So how are you doing so far this fiscal year? Okay.
Sherry, has Susan talked to Lori also?
Yes.
She talked with Chuck Patterson. We're a little bit unique in that. I think I alluded to this earlier, but we are we work as a team. So you don't get an individual investment advisor. We truly do come as a team. Chuck and I are indispersable. We have two other members on our outside service team that we actually meet with the communities, and then we have an inside investment team that do all the analytical work, make all the investments, do all the trades. So we have a full, robust team back in the office. Tom Bartholomew sets the macro environment of, you know, this is what's happening out there, and where we're, you know, where he wants these things positioned, and then he works with Joshua Paul and Josh passes that all down onto the investment team. We currently, besides municipalities, we have about $845 million in funds for Massachusetts municipalities under investment. And beyond that, we have about 1.4 as a firm as a whole, including private clients and that. So it's a fairly robust company with a lot of investment experience.
Do you have any return information in here at all?
Pardon me?
Do you have any return information in here, like past performance?
No, we find it difficult to report past performance, first of all, with privacy laws. And but we give our client list, so you can certainly reach out to different individual clients. The problem we're having with, like, say, OPEB funds, if we were to look at them all, we have people that started in 2009. Mm-hmm. And we have communities starting all different times, all different. Some are conservative, some are aggressive. They don't let us break them out separately because we're not allowed to give individual performances for different communities. And so it's a little difficult to give those past performance numbers per se.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I always think it's interesting when you talk about investing taxpayer money.
Or any money. But definitely taxpayer money, yep.
Right, I mean...
You have to be...
As an example, we can talk about how we paid off the school reconstruction because it was through... We took the lump sum from the school building authority, we invested it, and we were able to take 20-year program and pay it down in 10.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that was an example of very...
It's a good use of funds. I'm sure the taxpayers appreciate the fact that...
You're so right when you talk about, and even then we talked about what level of risk, and at that time the treasurer says, well, there's only so many things that you can invest in to begin with, and they're not going to let you go down to Foxwoods and put it on black. And
you're pretty restricted in different funds.
But again, I go back to that treasurer collector interview. Was it? Well, I just like to dabble in the stock market, and it's like, okay.
Yeah.
And you would understand because you were a treasurer collector, and you're an assessor. It's so hard to find people that have municipal experience. 30 years is like a lifetime in municipal.
Mm-hmm.
It is, yeah.
And we've been exceptionally lucky. I think we had Charlotte was treasurer collector for a while, and she did an amazing job. We had some very good, and we went from a point we had an elected treasurer collector not too long ago, 18, 19, 20 years ago, to an appointed, and I thought. That was pretty good on our residents to recognize that maybe just electing somebody may not be a good idea.
It's become a highly specialized field. I did, when I first started, I was elected, started as an elected tax collector.
So what's your thought about that now?
I firmly believe in, at the time, I would get grief from different areas. It was nice to be elected, but just the specialty of this particular field, it's amazing what treasurers are required to know, the specialized knowledge that they need to know, and the amount of cost, if they're done wrong, that it costs a lot of communities, it is amazing. So it really, I'm all about appointed at this point in time, just because sometimes you can't find somebody in your community that's willing to come in and take that job. And you might need to get outside the community, and sometimes you're lucky. A lot of communities are very lucky. They have some fabulous people that have been in and dedicated themselves to it. They do have an annual school to train and stuff. As a matter of fact, I'm one of the instructors at the school. But it's a pretty, when you look at all the different courses that they have to take and all the different fields that a treasurer has to manage through, it's pretty highly specialized.
And again, I just know it's not, I think, the hardest position for us to hire someone in the financial, either accountant, treasurer, collector. To me, those are very hard positions to hire because they're very, people in those positions usually don't move that often.
Mm-hmm.
Because usually by the time you get comfortable in it, you've been there 5 or 7 or 8 years. And by that time, you don't want to move any longer. So if we had, I would think that, I guess we probably need to sit down with Susan now.
Yeah.
And we have to figure out how do we put it all on black, right?
Right.
And let it roll, or maybe red.
Susan and I met with Chuck and Brian about a month ago to kind of talk things out, and Chuck gave a good overview and presentation of the program, but we wanted to make sure that the board was on board. And
we started back with Gatsby 34 when they started telling us we had to look at, we had to start putting all our roads and buildings and schools into our account sheets, and that's something that we had never done. So I would say over the last 20 years, the accounting for municipalities has grown tremendously.
It has.
Or the requirements, let's put that.
We're actually meeting with an auditing firm Wednesday, Chuck and I. They've asked us to come in because now they have to, some new auditing issues on their thing is, you know, the fair market value and how to account for all these different investments. So they asked us to come in and give, they have about 25 on staff there. They go out and do the municipal audits, and they're like, could you come in and just narrow down on this, how to deal with this, because it's becoming, most communities have a lot of money, millions, millions. Some of our accounts are up over $50 million.
Really?
There's not OPEB accounts, but yeah. Although they will need to get up there. So we have communities that have hundreds of millions of dollars in unfunded liabilities. So,
right, the bigger communities, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. Well, do you know what your unfunded liability is? Yeah.
I don't know off the top of my head. No.
Yeah. I don't know the exact number, but I know it's about $1 million, right? A little bit over, I think.
So you're a regional school district.
Yes.
So you don't have as much because the school district
anyway.
Has to recognize that unfunded liability on their books. It's probably a lot higher than the community.
And they have started, I think their school committee have been talking about it for the last couple of years. Mm-hmm. I think we may be a little bit quicker just because usually that's important to, I think we typically are a little more conservative with school committees, mm-hmm. boards of selectmen for the most part. So, and that's just, I know it's a generalization, but typically we appear to, you know, when it comes to financial like that, we're a little bit more recognize that need.
Yeah.
So we have to have a long-term view.
We've been paying attention to it for a little while.
Yeah,
so.
The schools are, their budgets, they tend to look more at student focus.
Right, they have a different focus.
And,
than we do.
We've only really in the last couple of years started bringing school districts on, you know, with funding for their OPEB liabilities. So we're starting to see them. They're dribbling in. Certainly not as robust as the communities are, the cities and towns.
Yeah, but we're just, and I think in debt's even changing also because, and again, like a school district, they're pretty much used to giving an assessment. Mm-hmm. You know, they give us an assessment, we pay the bill. And now it's the whole OPEB thing's a little bit different. You know, it's like that. It's a responsibility, and they understand it. They just, mm-hmm. but they also have to try to figure out how do they start billing for it. Also,
right.
You know. So for us, we've been using as part of our free cash. We have a policy for stabilization and free cash and OPEB. Mm-hmm. We're trying to work that into.
And that's what the rating agencies, if you go out to borrow and say you have Moody's or S&P come in and talk, and they're going to say, what's your unfunded liability? How much have you put aside for it? What is your policy for funding this? So they want to know that you've addressed that. Now, some communities do, say, a certain portion of free cash. Some have solar, you know, take pilot money, you know, from new solar arrays, windmills. Some have... We have communities that have a lot of hotels or restaurants,
mm-hmm.
And they're taking meals tax, a certain portion of the meals tax. I have a community that's paying their entire OPEB unfunded liability at a portion of the meals tax that they're collecting.
Yeah.
Others are like saying, well, we're doing this small, we're only realizing a portion of it now. However, when we fully fund our pension, we're going to divert that fund to the OPEB at that point in time, and then that should, you know, speed kick that one in a little bit higher.
So if you're sitting on this side of the table, mm-hmm. what would you look for in someone to partner with?
Well, you want to have someone who has municipal experience, first of all, because it's a highly specialized field, and there are rules and regs, and there are accounting rules that need to be met. Through that, and you certainly want to get someone who your auditors are going to recognize that, okay, they're abiding by the rules and regs, and you're not going to get rid of that. You also want to be looking at costs, you always have to be mindful of cost. You want to look at history. What type of history do they have? That one of the reasons we have in there that the client list in there. We're a financial institution. We cannot tell you who we work with unless they sign a privacy release. Right. And all we have is we'll provide you with is the community, the treasurer's name and phone number, and you can call and look at do that. It's got to be somebody who's responsive that can work with. Anyone, whomever your treasurer is, if you've got a new one coming on, and can they explain what this is and how it works and what they need to do and their role in the whole process? So you want to have somebody that kind of. We always think of ourselves as value add. We bring a whole lot more to the table than just. We don't just invest the money. We bring the whole education piece. We bring the accounting piece. We're responsive. We come out when you need us. We don't make you come into our office. We run that the gamut that way for you.
Good. David, any questions?
No, that's it right now. Thanks.
Jerry, thoughts? Lots of questions?
Maybe just a little bit. Can you touch on the cost and how that's?
In the back section.
The chart in the back.
The last section on there. We have our fee schedule. And the way our costs work, we look at the community as a whole. So we, if you have other funds invested with us, whether they be trust funds or stabilization funds or whatever, we look at that as a whole. Some of the communities that have the school districts that have come in, now we look at, well, you're part of that school district. So we take that into account also.
You got the basis points based on that.
Yeah. So how much do you have in your fund?
Oh, we have a little over 50,000.
50,000. So you're running, in the less than the 1 million. So it's 65 basis points, which is 0.65%. So less than 1%. So it's on the assets under management, and that's what we would charge for a yearly cost. Okay? And that comes, you don't pay that to us. It comes out of the income of the fund.
Right, yeah.
So it comes out of the trust.
Well, we get up to 20 million. We're in the.
I have
you guys are just giving the money.
I have them up there.
Do you?
I got quite a few communities that are at 20 basis points. So you can strive for that.
We're on our way.
There you go. There you go.
Well, Paxton's probably there. Paxton's a rich.
Paxton struggles with the budget. They really, really do. And we have a high tax rate, and
we got a beautiful public safety building.
We do, and we're paying that.
Who designed it?
And that's cool. You do.
Yeah.
You involved with that at some point. Well, it is gorgeous.
It is gorgeous.
It
yes,
is gorgeous.
Absolutely.
But we do. We have not funded. Anything towards our OPEB yet.
Really?
And, we struggle with our budget every year, and, the services slide every year. Our school is, we're part of a regional school district, so.
Are you with Rutland also?
We're with Rutland, Princeton, Sterling, and Holden. Wachusett,
that's right.
Yeah, I think Tantasca is Sturbridge.
Hmm.
Yeah. And
Sturbridge,
yeah.
What's so, that one on, what road was that? 117. Is that 117? In Bolton?
Oh, that's Neshoba? Is that one Neshoba?
Yeah, that's
yeah.
It.
Yeah, that's Starling. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's interesting. We all do struggle with try to make everything fit, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter what part of the state you're in.
Yeah, it doesn't. It's just, our how wealthy or poor your community is, it's they all struggle. Although some don't struggle as much. I must admit, I'm in communities where they don't struggle. They don't, which is amazing. But they have the infrastructure. They have the large commercial thriving businesses.
Well, sometimes you're lucky about where you are.
Yeah.
Sometimes your geographic position, whoever decided to put the intersection of 495 and Route 2 at a certain point, whoever decided to do that, that you just happen to be.
Yeah.
I mean.
Well, you can't get anywhere from Paxton.
Yeah, no.
You travel a half hour to get to a major road. So.
Yeah, on 122.
22.
122, but that's not a major road. I'm talking about, like, if you want it to get to the Pike, or you either have to travel clear across the city, or you have to travel through, like, Leicester and Auburn to get out west to get on the Pike, or you just travel right across the whole heart of the whole city, which takes you a long time to do that, so.
It's in the middle.
Or 290 or 190 or anything like this. It's a half-hour drive. It's a beautiful community, though. I love it. I wouldn't live anywhere else.
No, it's a nice town. I mean, I drive through it a lot. And yeah. It's a nice town. But, and you're right, but you don't think of that. I don't think you really think about that stuff when you live. If you don't live there, it's like,
right.
Well, how do we get anywhere?
Yeah.
You know, for us, you know, I think about it for me. What? 2 minutes I can get on 91 and
great.
I can go anywhere I want to go.
Yeah, see, that we don't have a major road to get there.
No.
Yeah. So we're pretty much a really nice bedroom community for the city of Worcester. But if you're traveling like I do a lot, it's kind of inconvenient to get anywhere.
Good. All right. So we'll probably have to have a conversation with Susan pretty soon. Yeah, the only way you get good town accountants, treasurers, treasurers, collectors is if you steal them from other communities.
I know, it's kind of... Well, there's a feeding ground now in the association now also educates the assistants.
Well, yeah, you can't really go to school. Like, if you want a fire chief, you can...
Yeah. Anne Marie College has a wonderful program for firefighters and police. Yeah.
If you want a police chief, there's a degree program.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if anybody that has any college around that has a municipal.
No, it's
finance or Massachusetts municipal.
Yeah, not so much the treasurer collector. They do. Clark University has a nice program for public administrators.
Yes.
So on that level. But this is really the education for these comes to the association. So you do pay into that. You pay dues for your treasurer to belong, and they provide the schooling, which is, it's intensive.
Absolutely.
And, 3 years of classes and then exams and stuff like that to get them trained on that. The beauty of being in municipal is you're not in competition with your neighbor. So you can call up your neighbor and say, how'd you do this?
Mm-hmm.
How'd you handle that? And so fostering their associations, in the different groups gives them contacts with a lot of other treasurers. So you can always ask somebody else in another community how they handle things. And that's been how most people get their education.
Good. Well, thank you for taking the time tonight.
May I approaching? Give a
Absolutely.
Card. Thank you. There you go.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Very nice to meet you
thank
all.
You
I appreciate the opportunity. And have a lovely evening.
You too. Awesome. Have a good drive back.
Thank you.
Okay. Sherry, let's see. Are you already at the 4th of July?
Yeah.
Pretty much. Getting there.
4th of July is coming up, and town offices will be closed on Independence Day observance. July 11th will be our next scheduled Board of Selectmen meeting. I will not be here.
All right.
Oh, okay.
And I got my first judging assignment as a CBJ coming up Sunday.
You gotta tell people what that is. They don't.
Yeah, what's a CBJM?
Certified Barbecue Judge.
Oh, great! Good for you. Go, Tom.
At the Vermont State Barbecue Championships.
Where is that?
Waterbury, Vermont.
Nice.
We'll see. We're looking for it. Okay. Anything else, Davey?
No, that's it. Motion to adjourn.
I'll second for discussion. Sherry, again, I just want to thank you for staying on top of this community compact. And again, small towns like us, a lot of times lose out on grants.
Yes.
They usually go to bigger communities. They
people
go
who have can have people get on that and stuff.
Or by the time we get it, it's past us.
Yeah, there's nothing left.
And I think that we're in a good position because we've had a lot of committees and people that have done a lot of legwork over the year. Yeah. And I'm amazed at how Sherry just picks it up and goes. So
yeah, you have great committee people. You have good planning documents. So a lot of what I need is right at my fingertips. And people have just been amazing, you know, to help me through the parts that I don't know. So yeah, we're in good shape.
But Sherry's been a very good fit. I mean, it's tough to come in. You're doing a great job.
Thank you.
Well, sometimes you don't get enough time to say it.
It's true.
And I want people to know at home also, it's important. You know, they come in, they can talk to Sherry about things, and if she doesn't have the answer, she'll find it. And I think that's a key. If you don't have an answer, she'll find the answer for you. It may take a little bit, but she'll get an answer. And I think that's important. I think getting the right answer is more important than getting an answer. So
I would agree with that.
So for me, I think it's very—I think it's very important. I think our board does also. I know Scott and David, that they both value that also. So
definitely.
Anything else, David, besides your motion?
No, that's it.
All right. So we have a motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Sherry, at 7:45, we shall declare ourselves out of this meeting and adjourned. Thank you.